first and last wonderful grace of Jesus as we all stand.
Blessing on this service tonight. We've already prayed. We're going to pray some more. But also tonight, we're going to remember Reverend and Mrs. Chris Emery. We just found out just 10 minutes ago that their daughter passed away today. Is that correct, right? Is that what they told me in the prayer room? Is that correct? Today. She passed, right, Brother Perry? Where you at, Brother Perry? There you are. Is that today, right? So pray for her name's Joy. Pray for the family. And then Denham Street Baptist Church, I may say a word later, but I just tell you they haven't made any progress in apprehending the suspect yet. Church is brokenhearted. They haven't received their friends tonight. So specifically, Brother David, let's remember the Emory family and then the Denham Street Baptist Church.
So good to us, dear God, Lord. Thank you for saving us, dear God, Lord, at early age. Dear God, Lord, we didn't deserve it, still don't deserve it. But thank God that you saved us, dear God, Lord. Lord, thank God where we was born, we can hear the preach word of God, dear God. We've been blessed all these years to hear the shout of the king in the camp, Lord. We don't take it for granted. But we know a lot of places around, Lord, don't have this kind of spirit in the church service. Lord, we thank that you show up and meet with us, dear God, when we come to church. Lord, we thank you for that, Lord. Thank you for the blessings you've given us, Lord. Pray for the Emory family, dear God, Lord, and the passing of Joy, dear God, Lord. Pray that you touch them and help them and stand by them. Dear God, pray for Denham Street Baptist Church, Lord. No doubt, all them years that lady stood with her fan of God there at that church, dear God, Lord. And, Lord, they're heartbroken, dear God. Pray that you touch them and help them, dear God, Lord. Stand by them, Lord, no matter what happens. Lord, pray for the Robinson family here, dear God, Lord. Thank you for Lord, the spirit they've had, dear God, and what they showed us, dear God, Lord. We pray that you still stand by them and watch over and take care of them. Lord, stay close to them, dear God, Lord. Pray for the message that was preached this morning, dear God, Lord. Lord, somebody's here lost, Lord, to get saved before it's everlasting too late. Don't let them get away from that message you heard this morning, dear God, Lord. Ain't no place to go to hell, dear God, Lord. Ain't no place you'd want to spend eternity, dear God, Lord. Have them make that decision before it's everlasting too late. Lord, be on these young people as they sing. Lord, touch their lives. Lord, they'd live their life for you. They'd see a need in a young age to live their life for you, dear God, Lord, that you'd bless them. Bless this church. Bless the man of God you preaches tonight. Jesus, you might pray, amen.
I am humbled by the grace.
say amen to that good song. The Lord's good. Amen. He's good to us. Listen, he's good to us when things are going well, and he's good to us when things are not going so well. Goodness of God leads man to repentance. Thank God for that great song. It's a new one, and they'll get better and better at those new songs. We appreciate the young people and also all the musicians and also the adult choir as well. Let's have the ushers come on in. We're going to go ahead and get the regular tithes and offerings. Going to ask Brother Mullinax to sing one for us, if he would. In a little bit, if you'll come on up in the choir loft and or your family. Well, good to have Brother Mullinax, his family with us tonight. Missionary to China, taking the gospel to lands that are not so friendly about the gospel. But we appreciate him and what he's trying to do for the Lord. And we have time for another group or two. It's fine. Remember all these prayer requests we've given you a little while ago. Right now we're going to do the offering. If you're going to Lake Greenwood, please see Perry Thomas immediately after the service. Immediately after the service. And go ahead and take care of that. And Sowers and Reapers is September 2nd and 16th. Keep that in mind, please. And then if you'd like to go, and I don't expect anybody to go, I really don't. But if you want to go Tuesday night, that we need to leave at 5:45. We need to leave at 5:45 because the service starts at 7 at Progress Baptist Church, where Brother Raines is the pastor there up in, well, it's actually beyond Hendersonville. So, but again, if you'd like to go, you're welcome to go 5:45, all right? God bless you. Y'all shall serve you. You worship God and you're giving, all right? After he gets done, how about you, Derek, and your brother come sing that song again, okay? The one y'all sung the other night, if y'all will. Step up here, Brother Mark. We'll ask the blessing on the offering, praying for all these special prayer requests. And let me give you another important request that maybe some of you don't know about. Our brother prayed about it a moment ago. Kenny and Peggy Rogers, you know, they're up in years, and he's just really afraid to drive, especially on the interstates. And they love coming here. They truly love coming here, and the driving now is hindering them. So they have a Moore address, but it's not really Moore. I don't believe it's on the west side of town. If anybody would think about or contemplate maybe hooking up with them, just make it a matter of consideration, please, and maybe rendezvous, and maybe they won't have to come as far and meet you somewhere on the west side and bring them on to church, because I know they love to come, and they hate when they're not able to be here. And I tell you, the thing about all that, all of us are going the same route, amen? We are, and we're not going to be able to do what we one time did, so Brother Kenny's just real apprehensive about driving right now. So some of you think about that, all right? Brother Mark, take the offer and pray for these things.
Father, we pray, God, and thank you for allowing us to be in church tonight. Lord, we pray, God, for these special requests the pastor's made mention. Lord, we do pray for the Denham Street Baptist Church tonight. At this time, all they're going through, all that the family is going through, all those situations surrounding the sad tragedy there, God, we pray, God, and we know you do have your way in the whirlwind, God, and we pray that that would be the case there. Tonight, Lord, we do pray for the passing of Brother Emery and his wife's precious daughter. Lord, we do pray, God, for the situation there. Comfort them is no only doubt, God, that you can do in situations like this. No doubt there's a great bond between parents and children like that, God. Pray, God, you'd comfort them, God, and then for all of our aging members here in the church, the Rogers family, Lord, and not only them, God, but others in our church that are aging, God, they have failing minds, failing health, unable to be here. We pray, God, you would encourage them, God, in these golden years of their life, Lord, that you would be a comfort to them. God, be real to them. Be real in this service tonight. God, I pray for the singers. Give them liberty. The pastor, give him liberty. And then bless this offering, God, we've received, God, that be used for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you very much. All right, Brother Mullinax, if you'll come on. So good to have him. And let's let the family stand, all right? Let's let the family stand. We're so glad y'all are here. Now, I don't know the gentleman. Is he, like, dating, liking, friend, or... Oh, engaged. You're only 12, aren't you? I mean, my goodness. God bless you. Congratulations. And are you taking him overseas with you?
We're working on it.
Yeah, just saying. All right, God bless you.
It's good to be with you folks tonight. I appreciate your pastor. Appreciate you as a church and helping and supporting our ministry and work in China. Real quick, if you would remember, pray for us. I leave to go back to China in about 2 weeks. And we have some special deliveries that we're working on. I won't go into detail, but we have memory cards that we've downloaded. And that shipment, the Lord willing, will be going into North Korea. And so please pray about that. The ones involved physically in doing those deliveries, that's dangerous work. And I know with the climate that's going on, North Korea's in the news every day. And our knee-jerk reaction is, well, we should just nuke that place and get rid of the problem. And I'm all for defending our country. Don't misunderstand me. But if that was to happen, there would be millions of souls that would drop off into hell. Because most of those people have never heard the gospel. Most of them. And so please pray about that. Pray that those shipments will be protected and be able to get in. There is an underground church even in North Korea. There's believers there, and they're greatly persecuted, greatly oppressed, but I'm thankful that our God can take care of them. He knows where they're at. Amen. And they're hungry for the word of God, so pray that we can get those deliveries. I'd appreciate that. This world's in a mess, no doubt, but I'm thankful tonight for the peace of God. Aren't you? A song right out of your Redback church hymnal. I could not go on without you. I know the world would overwhelm my soul, for I could not see the right way to go when temptations Then he whispers sweet peace to me. He whispers sweet peace to me when I am cast down and troubled. Dispels all fear, and when I'm in doubt or troubled in soul, that still small voice I can hear, and he whispers sweet peace to down and troubled in When I am cast down and I'm troubled in soul, He whispers sweet peace to me.
Thank you, brother, so much. And you're leaving in 2 weeks?
Yes.
Leaving in 2 weeks. You have some needs? There's some needs on for the trip, brother? You have to tell me. Do you have some needs for the trip?
Pay for
some. All right. We'll talk to us after service. We'll definitely get on board with that. I believe in what he's doing. I want you to believe in what he's doing. I tell you, I'm glad to see him, not me. Amen. I don't want to go nowhere over there with them bunch of folks that don't want nothing to do with the gospel. But they need the gospel. They need the gospel. All right, this trio, then we're going to preach.
Man has climbed every mountain, no matter how high. He has conquered the planets from sky to sky, but there is a place where man has not been. That's where my Lord said He's buried my sins, in the depths of the sea of God's forgetfulness, removed as He is from where.
People said, thank you so much. We appreciate that good singing. Appreciate all the singing tonight, choirs, musicians, everybody. Appreciate you taking a part. I want you to take your Bibles now. Go to 1 Peter chapter 3, everybody. And my voice is so weak. I preached pretty strong this morning. I tried to anyway. Glad I'm not going to the lake of fire, by the way. Thank God. Thought about while this trio just got up and sung. Neither one of them have earrings in their ear. Yeah. Hair's not in a ponytail. They don't have skinny jeans on. Oh, God. It's terrible. And terrible what's going on this day and hour. Disgusting, amen. We're going to hold fast to the right. By the help and grace of God, we're going to hold fast to the right. Amen. By the grace of God, that's what we intend on doing. Well, last Sunday night, if you were here, and most of you were here, we preached on blessing of companionship, or the joys of companionship, or the harmony and companionship. Tonight, I want to kind of go along that vein again, not the same subject, but a subject nonetheless very important and very, very interesting. I want to tell you that, not because I'm preaching it, but it's very, very interesting, and it's going to be hopefully an eye-opener. 1 Peter 3, verse 1, look at the first word, okay, likewise. Now, that's a different word to start a chapter or a division or a sentence with. And so when Brother Galloway says likewise, it's almost like you need to look backwards. You look backwards. And so I think backwards is chapter 2, verse 18. Look at it. I believe backwards, Brother Mullen, Acts chapter 2, verse 18. Servants, be subject to your masters with all fear. That's talking to servants. So he's continuing that thought. And then he says in chapter 3, verse 1, likewise, ye wives.
Yep.
See, same umbrella here.
Yep.
Be in subjection. I need some amens.
Yep.
To your own husbands.
Right.
God knows we believe in that around here.
Yep.
God knows that the Bible teaches that.
Yep.
Ladies, I want to tell you that your relationship with your husband is a reflection of your relationship with your Lord. Because you submit as unto the Lord. Verse number one, that if any obey not the word, a lost person, they also may without the word be won by the conversation or the conduct, the lifestyle of the wives. How? While they behold your chaste conversation,
yep,
coupled with fear. Not fear of the husband, but the reverence and fear of God. Now listen to this verse, ladies. Please listen. We need this. Who's adorning? Talking about the wives. Let it not be that outward adorning of plaiting the hair,
right,
and of wearing of gold, or of putting on of apparel. Now let me help our Church of God friends right here. That verse is not forbidding fixing the hair nor wearing of gold ornamentation at all. Because if that was the case, then also what would be forbidden would be the putting on of apparel. And you know a man's a stark raving idiot if he forbids a woman to put on apparel. So that's not what it's teaching. Not what it's teaching. What it is teaching is the emphasis to the beauty of a woman is not on the outside, but it's on the inside. Amen. But let it, verse 4, but let it be the hidden man of the heart, and that which is not corruptible, even the ornament of a meek and quiet spirit, which is in the sight of God of great price. I think ladies, Christian ladies, that have a meek and a quiet spirit, they're not loud. They're not boisterous. They don't demand attention. They don't butt in with men or talking. They're rather we're gonna have a good time tonight. I can feel it already. They're rather shamefacedness. And they don't exert themselves around men. Say amen. A meek and a quiet spirit. That's a Bible. The Bible said it's of great price in the sight of God. And then also I think that women, Christian ladies that have a meek and a quiet spirit, They don't go on to Facebook and Instagram and all this other social media and lambast people and talk bad and throw barbs, say amen, and nitpick and tear people down and jump on everybody's bandwagon. I'm beginning to wonder if some Christian ladies I know don't want to be a professional bandwagon riders, jumping on everybody's soapbox. Jumping on everybody's fussing and griping. You just chime in. Say, why'd they do that? Because you don't have a meek and a quiet spirit. You run your mouth too much is what you do. That's what you do. But God said that which is of great price is a woman with a meek and a quiet spirit. For verse 5, for after this manner, in the old time, the holy women, underline that word holy, the holy women, also, who trust in God, adorn themselves, being in subjection unto their own husbands, even as Sarah obeyed Abraham. You men like that, right? You like that? Well, hold on to verse 7. If you like that, let's get verse 7 in a minute. But the Bible said that Sarah obeyed Abraham. So, ma'am, why did you get married? Did you get married just to get out of the house? Did you get married because you didn't want your mom and dad's authority anymore? Don't you realize you're accepting another man's authority?
Right.
And if you're not willing to submit and be in subjection, then maybe you ought to stay single. Say amen.
Right. Right.
Bible said even as Abraham called him, Lord, whose daughters you are, as long as you do well and are not afraid with any amazement. Now here's my, you men just got all antsy on me. You got all amen on me. And I appreciate it. But lucky you. We got something for you tonight. We got something for us men. Here's my thought. Likewise, as the same manner, ye husbands, dwell with them according to knowledge. Yeah, that deserves a laugh. No, what do you mean? You got to try to learn something about her. You got to try to figure her out. You may spend 6 or 7 years doing it, but if God says to do it, say amen. What have you learned in all your married life? I've learned that I haven't learned anything. Say amen. I haven't learned anything yet. Watch this, my responsibility. Dwell with them according to knowledge, giving honor unto the wife.
Right.
Now, how many amens we're going to get now? Let's finish the verse. As unto the weaker vessel, and as being heirs, now this is an unusual phrase right here, and as being heirs together of the grace of life. I may not get back to that, but I want to tell you something about a marriage. There's some spiritual bonds.
Yeah.
I've never heard anybody preach that. There's some spiritual bonds. Right there. Being heirs, Brother Ben, together of the grace of life. Listen, it's not just a physical and a marital bond. There is a spiritual bond in a marriage. You're heirs together, the grace of life. Now, here's where I really want to go tonight, and this is it. That your prayers be not hindered.
Right.
We're supposed to be praying people.
Right.
Gentlemen, we're supposed to be praying husbands. Somebody help me. Church, we're supposed to be praying people. Say amen.
Amen.
We're supposed to have a prayer life.
Right.
Now, I thought about this, Brother Randy. I do enough, and my own spiritual immaturity, my own carnality, to hinder my own prayers.
You're right.
I sure don't need to add
what
that verse is talking about.
Right.
Did you know what this verse is teaching?
Go ahead.
Does anybody care to understand what this verse is teaching?
Yeah.
That it's actually possible for me to hinder my own prayers because of the way I treat my wife.
Oh.
That's serious business.
Right.
I want to preach tonight on disharmony brings disinterest. Disharmony in the home, disharmony in the marriage, disharmony in the marriage relationship. You know what it will do? It will bring disinterest. You know what I thought about, Brother Randy? Here's what happens. But me and her's not getting along. And we've been agitated at each other. And we've been ill-tempered with each other. We're unforgiving towards each other. And we've got some aughts and bitter feelings against each other right now. We have them. And so here's what people will do. Here's what they'll do. If I'm living that way towards my wife, or my wife is living that way towards me, Brother Mom, actually, here's what will happen. A what's the use in praying? What's the use in praying? And that's what he's talking about, that your prayers be not hindered. Gentlemen, I'd like to say to you tonight that you and I have the most awesome responsibility known to man. And that is, listen to me now, to live in such a way, to conduct ourselves in such a way, to have such a home, such a family. By the way, and I need a lot of amens tonight. Are us men not supposed to be the high priest of the home? Is that not taught in this book right here? Now listen, all those King Kongs, are we not supposed to be the spiritual leader? I mean, have I been misinformed all my life? Are us men not supposed to be the spiritual leader of the home and family? And so if there's any hindrance to prayers going on, I said, if there's any hindrance to prayers going on, then why do we want to blame her? Why do we want to blame those children? Why do we want to blame the church? Why do we want to blame the school? Why do we want to blame the job? This book right here said that Peter said, you better give honor to that wife. You better give deference to that wife. You better value that wife. I said, you better value that wife. You better treat her with kindness. You better treat her with consideration. You better treat her with respect. You better honor her. You better honor her. Because if you don't honor her, it's going to interrupt your prayer life. It's going to affect your prayer life. It's going to stymie your prayer life. It can very well affect to such a degree that not only will there be disharmony in the home, disharmony in the marriage, but then, Miss Stephanie, it turns to disinterest and you throw up your hands. And you know what? You know what? You know what's the exact truth. You go into the presence of God. You kneel somewhere, you get in an automobile somewhere, and you want to talk to God, you want to pray, but you got this heavy cloud hanging over you. I wish I had somebody. You know good and well things aren't right at the house. You know good and well you haven't talked to her right. You haven't treated her right. You know she's upset with you, and you're upset with him, and on and on and on. God says be careful. He says be careful that your prayers be not hindered. According to Peter, in this passage right here, the husband's insensitivity. So you're going to blame me all night? Yes, I am. I'm going to man up. I'm going to man up. And I'm going to tell you, 99 to 9/10% of the problem is us men's leadership. It's us men's leadership. According to Peter, the husband's, everybody okay? The husband's insensitivity towards his wife. This staggers me, Brother Ben, may cause spiritual disruption in marriage. A husband's insensitivity to his wife may cause spiritual disruption in marriage. And marital discord, and there's a lot of it going on in this country, marital discord in turn becomes a hindrance to answered prayer. We've often, let me give you a couple more quotes, all right? If I can find all my quotes, yeah. There are various reasons, of course, why our prayers seem to go unanswered. I said there are various reasons why it seems that our prayers go unanswered, but oftentimes we need look no further than our own bedroom, our own kitchen, our own living room to find out why. I would conjecture and believe tonight that some of you have just about given up on prayer. I would say there are probably some men in this sanctuary tonight that used to pray. They used to have a time with God. They used to have devotion. Somebody say amen. They used to spend time in the Word. They used to spend time with the Lord. But because of things that's going on in your life, with your marriage, your family, your home, you've just to phone up your hands in despair and say, what's the use? God's not going to hear me. God's not going to listen. I won't get anything out of it. Hello. I won't get anything out of it. There's just no sense in praying. My prayers are not going to get any higher than the ceiling. And if you truly, truly, truly feel that way, and that's what you're experiencing tonight, then why not somebody do something about it? Say amen. Why don't somebody do something about it? You say, what am I supposed to do about it? Why don't you do what Peter said? Why don't we take heed to the word of God? Why don't we just be what men ought to be, what Christians ought to be? You say, well, what is the answer, preacher? What is the answer, preacher? It's pretty simple, sir. It's pretty simple, sir. Honor your wife. Honor your wife. Honor her as your helpmate, as the weaker vessel, as the lady you fell in love with, as the lady you vowed to stay married to. Honor her and treat her with due consideration and due respect and due treatment. And I promise you, the interest in your prayer life, thank God, it will return. Amen. Prayers are hindered. Prayers are hindered when the husband lapses into low standards of marital conduct. Satan therefore seizes the opportunity. A husband's failure to treat his wife with love, with kindness and consideration and courtesy plays havoc with his prayers. It plays havoc with his prayers. So concerned is God that Christian husbands live in an understanding and loving way with their wives that he interrupts his own relationship with that husband when they are not doing what God said to do towards your wife. Say, what do you mean by that? I'm simply trying to tell you that God will interrupt fellowship with you. God will interrupt. I believe this. I believe it. God will interrupt fellowship with you. You're not treating your wife with the honor that she deserves. In other words, if things aren't right in the home, if things aren't right in the family, if things aren't right in the marriage, listen to me, I do not believe they'll be right between you and the Lord. They cannot. They cannot. Who in this church, let me ask you a question, church. Who in this church can stand to suffer an interruption of fellowship? I didn't say relationship. You know better than that. Who in this church, Brother Galloway, can stand to suffer and experience an interruption in fellowship? Who among us, what husband among us doesn't like to know the joy bells of God in your soul? What husband among us don't like to know the peace of God that passeth all understanding? What husband among us doesn't relish and cherish and thrill and delight at sitting down with an open table of the word of God and God feeding his soul? I wish I had somebody. God ministering to his heart. What husband among us doesn't like to spend a few moments each day in prayer to God and God refresh him and strengthen him and encourage him and bless him and minister to him? Amen. Minister to it. Why would you throw that away? Why would you throw that to the curb? Why would you give up on that? Why would you not want that anymore? I tell you, that ought to be the greatest desire of our heart, is to fellowship with God and to walk with God and to talk with God and to hear his voice and to be in communion with him. And I'm telling you tonight, according to this passage in 1 Peter chapter 3 and verse number 7, that it is possible to hinder your prayer, interrupt your fellowship, suspend those holy influences, and it's all based on how we treat our wife. Everybody okay? It is most significant to see the relationship between the prayer life, watch this, and the love life of husbands and wives. I said it is most significant to see the relationship between the prayer life and the love life of husbands and wives. In other words, one can affect the other. And let's just take all the veneer off, okay? Let's take all the varnish off. Let's get real honest. How many among us knows exactly what I'm talking about? exactly what I'm talking about. It grieves you. I said it grieves you. It brings an uneasiness. There's no peace there. There's no contentment there. There's no rest there. You're agitated. There's an upsetness on the inside. Is everybody okay? There's an upsetness on the inside. It's not calm anymore. It's not calm. The calmness is gone. Hey, the birds have quit singing. The birds have quit singing. The music has stopped. The music is silenced. You go to work, but things just aren't right. You go to church, but things aren't right. You go to Sunday school class, and things aren't right. You go to the choir, and things aren't right. You teach your class, and things aren't right. You preach your sermon, and things aren't right. You go home, and you eat food, but things aren't right. Things are not right. You talk during the day, but things aren't right. You understand what I'm talking about? When there is disharmony, when there is disunity, when there is any bit of contention, any bit of strife, any bit of unforgiveness, any bitter feelings, any aggravation, any hate, any ill temper, ill treatment, disrespect, talking down, mistreatment of that precious lady who is your Christian wife. You can say what you want. You can smile all you want to smile. You can shout. You can say amen. You can preach. You can teach. You can sing. You can play. But I'm telling you, when things are not right between you and her, when things are not right between you and her, it affects you in a great way, in a great manner. And I tell you what I like. I tell you what I like. I'm glad, thank God, it doesn't have to stay that way. I said, I'm man enough to admit it. Say amen. I am glad, thank God, Brother Randy, it doesn't have to stay that way. Thank God somebody can say I'm sorry. I said somebody can say I'm sorry. Somebody can hug somebody. Somebody can embrace somebody. Somebody can get little missus by the hand and say, let's get down here by the bed. Let's pray about all this. I'm sorry, you're sorry. Let's confess it to God. Let's get it out of the blood. There's no sense in living this way. We're not living in a motel. This isn't a motel. This isn't Petticoat Junction. We ought to have a home. We ought to have a family. We ought to have love. We ought to have harmony. We ought to be some smiling going on. There ought to be some affection going on. There ought to be some cheer going on. There ought to be the right kind of respect and the right kind of treatment one towards another. And when all that's in place, thank God the presence of God is real. The blessings of God are real. And thank God your prayer life, thank God your prayer life doesn't suffer. And your prayer life is not thrown out the window, thrown to the curb. But thank God it's refreshing. It's encouraging. It's uplifted. Thank God the prayer life is what it ought to be. Amen. Your prayer life and your love life with your husband or wife affects one another. It affects one another. Failure to give honor to my wife. Failure to give honor to my wife. By the way, it's my responsibility to do that. Failure to give honor to my wife will result in a cutting away or an interruption of the efficiency of our united prayers. Now watch this last quote I'll give you and I'll move on. This is a quote right here, Brother Brian Travis. A husband's conduct towards his wife is to be his helpmeet for his prayers. I like that. A husband's conduct towards his wife is supposed to be his helpmeet for his prayers. Did you like that? That's good. That's good. She is our helpmeet. Somebody say amen. I said she is our helpmeet. But now watch my conduct toward her in turn becomes my helpmeet for my prayers. Wouldn't it be terrible if you're crippling your own prayers? I said, wouldn't it be terrible that you're crippling your own prayers? Wouldn't it be terrible that you now are at the stage, and I know I'm on target with this, I know I am. Wouldn't it be terrible to know that you're at the stage of disinterest in spiritual matters because of disharmony in your home? Wouldn't that be terrible to know that you are to blame, that your prayer life, your fellowship with God is interrupted, and it's all based on because you don't talk to her right, you don't treat her right, you don't love her like you're supposed to, you don't respect her, you don't honor her. By the way, let me tell the ladies, I want to smile out of you. Maybe not an amen, but could I at least get a smile, all right? You know what it means for me to honor my wife? Does anybody know what that means? It means I should value her. I should value that. Thank you, Jennifer. There's one. My wife's smiling. Miss McAbee's smiling. Not here smiling. Jonathan, you're smiling. You're not a wife. But your wife's sure smiling. Thank God. Amen. Miss Loving, smile. What a name. Amen. What a great name. Loving, that's a good name. Where'd y'all come up with that? That's pretty good. You just love each other all the time. Brother and sister, loving. What are y'all doing? Loving. I like it. Praise God. There's nothing wrong with that. Value her. It has the connotation of it has the connotation of special treatment.
Well, that's good.
How about courtesy? Somebody said if a man is still opening the door for his wife in the automobile, listen to this, if a man is still opening the door for his wife when they go to the automobile, there's one or two possibilities. Either that's a new wife or the car's new. Somebody say amen. What about courtesy? I'll tell you a big one to me. I think it's probably the biggest one. If you honor her, listen now, listen close. If you honor her, why do you talk to her like you do?
Well, that's good.
Why are you so harsh?
Good.
Why are you mean? Why do you chastise her with your words? Why do you put her down? Why? I'm asking you a question. You say, I'm going to jump up and say it. Say it right now. Come on. For a speak now, forever hold your peace. I'm ready. I'll shoot you down, but go ahead, say it.
Yeah.
Why do you say those things to her? Why do you cut her with your words?
Right.
Why do you cut her? Why do you belittle her? Why do you disrespect her? Why do you never praise her? Listen now, gentlemen. Please, you gentlemen, when I first started, it was amens all over the building. I mean, they're bouncing off the wall. Woo, glory to God, he's going to let them have it tonight. Oh, we got you. We're letting us have it. Say amen. I'm asking you, gentlemen, why do you say the things you say to her? Or why do you say them in the tone that you say them? Do you think that's honor to put her down? Do you think that's honor? Do you think that's honor to criticize her? Do you think that's honor to say abusive things to her? Hey, do you think, sir, do you think it's honor to say hurtful things to your wife? You say hurtful things? You say hurtful things to her that you wouldn't say to her parents or you would say to your parents, but you'll say them to her. Do you think that's honor? Is that honor? Is that honor to verbally abuse your wife? Is that honor? If that's honor, then I'm preaching the wrong thing.
Yep.
That's not honor.
Right.
When you honor somebody, you value them.
Peace.
When you honor somebody, you respect them.
Right.
When you honor somebody, you treat them with deference, is the word, Derek. The deference. When you honor somebody, you put, watch this, I got a lot of words up here. And I just know they're in my mind. When you honor somebody, you have a high esteem for them. I said, you have a high esteem for them. Did you know I read one author? You know what he said, Brother Randy? He said that every husband ought to have a special, listen to this. Oh my, it's going to get you under conviction, God. Every husband ought to have a special place of honor reserved in his heart only for his wife.
Right.
Woo! I said, every husband ought to have a special place of honor reserved in his heart only for his wife. Do we have that, guys? Do we want that? Are you after that? So I want mine to submit. I want mine to be in subjection. I want to be called Lord. Oh, shut up. I want to be called Lord. I want to be like Abraham. I want to take that verse. That verse is going to be my life verse. I figured it would. What about pray without ceasing? How about that for your life verse? How about giving? It shall be given you. It's pressed down, measured, pressed over, whatever. You know what I'm talking about. How about that for your life verse? I want her to bow at my feet. Hey, mister. Last to count, I reckon I didn't see a dog collar around your wife's neck.
Right.
You got to lead her and jerk her around like she's a little puppy dog. Somebody say amen.
Yeah.
That's not honor. He said, well, I'm the boss. She knows I'm the boss. She doesn't do anything unless I tell. In other words, you're such a boss, your wife don't even have her own mind to order her own food. Have you lost your ever-loving mind?
Yeah.
I knew it'd get quiet. It don't matter. I'll keep y'all here all night. I haven't preached an hour in a long time. Might as well start tonight. I'm not. Really? Really? Where's honor in that?
Yeah, right, yeah.
Birthdays, anniversaries. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Christmas, New Year's, Halloween. Oh, what do you get them for Halloween? I don't know. Get them a pumpkin. Who cares? Nothing special for them. You don't make anything special. You used to make something special. Now it's just another day. Now you've been married to the old hag for 37 years. That's your word, not mine.
Come on.
Is that honor? Is that honor, Trey? Is that honor? Somebody said, I want my wife to submit in everything. Well, who doesn't? My wife's going to submit in everything. Okay. I heard you all the way up here. I hear you all the way up here. She's going to submit or she's going to be a rebel. And I've already told her she's a rebel because she won't submit in everything. Well, let me just ask you something, Buster. Do you love her like Christ loved the church?
How about that? Preach it.
Do you love her like Christ loved the church? Are you willing to self-sacrifice for her? Are you willing to do without for her? Jesus laid down his life for the church. That's how much you love her.
Yeah.
You see, this whole idea of submission and lordship and leadership and subjection, husband's a boss, husband's a leader. Well, you know what you spell submission with? It's just another way of saying she loves him. And you know what headship is? I said, you know what headship is? Headship is not just control. Headship is saviorhood. Say amen. Christ loved the church and saviorhood loves her, protects her, cares about her, nourishes her, cherishes her, and thank God honors her as Christ honors the church. Amen. You say such mean things to her, that's not honor. You put her down, that's not honor. You belittle her in front of others, that's not honor. You never take her side, that's not honor. You're always against her, that's not honor. You never try to hear her out, that's not honor. You do not facilitate her, that's not honor. You will not let her be herself. You'd rather her be a puppy dog on a leash. And I want to tell you, that's not honor. That's not honor. Honor means esteem of the highest degree, great value. It means preciousness. And I want to ask the men tonight in this building, I want to ask the men, do you have a special place of honor? Do you have a special place of honor in your heart for no other woman on this earth except your wife? Is she first?
Yeah.
Is she first?
Good.
Is she number one? Ever occurred to you that some of your advice might be wrong? I knew that hit hard. Has it ever occurred to you that human beings don't have all the counsel and direction you need, including me? Has it ever occurred to you that all of us men don't have all the answers? Has it ever occurred to you that us men are a little biased on some of these subjects? We're little by all we want. Submission, submission, submission. I'm the boss. I'm the leader. I'm the man of the house. You're supposed to respect me as a man. You're supposed to follow me. Follow me. Follow me. You're supposed to follow me. Well, do you love her as Christ loved the church?
Good.
She might be more willing to follow if you love her like Christ loved the church. I'll tell you what you do. I'm going home, going to bed. That's what I'm going to do. I'll tell you what the rest of you do. Go home and sit her down and say, do I honor you? Do I honor you? Do I honor you in front of my family? Do I honor you in front of the church folk? Do I honor you in front of your family? Watch this, Brother David. Do I honor you in front of the children? In front of the children? Do the children know that you have a special place in my life? Do the children, can the children pick up on the atmosphere in that home? Is it contention and strife and disharmony which hinders the prayers? Or is it nothing but liquid love flowing everywhere? And those children know. Those children, and listen to this. I wonder if the children in our homes know that mom and daddy's madly in love. I said, I wonder if the children know, even the grown children. I wonder if the grown children know. You know, I'm going to tell you one thing. If we ever have a marriage, I want it to be like mom and dad's.
Yeah.
I want it to be like mom and dad's. Because mom and dad, they might have their differences once in a while. They might get sideways once in a while. And who doesn't? They get sideways once in a while. But I'll tell you one thing. They know how to forgive. They know how to say, I'm sorry. Some of you, listen, when you die, I am personally going to pay for the granite tombstone, and I'm going to say, now, finally, he's sorry. Because he never felt like he was sorry for anything while on planet Earth. We're not talking about buying cars and houses and new dresses and new skirts. They got enough of that. Somebody say amen. Got enough shoes, got enough jewelry, got enough all that nonsense. We're talking about how you treat her. We're talking about how you talk to her. We're talking about honor. Honor. Look at the verse 7. Likewise, ye husbands, dwell with them. Let me go ahead and give you an outline. Watch this. Dwell with them according to knowledge. Number one, we ought to concentrate. And God knows it takes a lot of concentration to dwell with them according to knowledge. Dwell with them according to knowledge. Look at the next one. Giving honor unto the wife as unto the weaker vessel and as being heirs together with the grace of life. Not only should we concentrate, but we ought to be considerate. I preached that about honor. We ought to be considerate. And then we ought to be cooperative, being heirs together. Heirs together, the grace of life. There ought to be some cooperation at home because they're not only marital, but they're spiritual bonds. And then the last part, you need to be careful. You need to be careful. You need to be careful. Why, preacher? Because you're fixing to affect your prayer life.
Yeah.
Matter of fact, it goes really beyond that, Brother Crooker. It says you can hinder your prayers. You can hinder your prayers. My, you know, I wonder, Brother David, what if an emergency comes up in your home, in my home, an emergency which could happen tonight? What if an emergency comes up? We put this all points bulletin, this all call. Oh, Lord, y'all pray. Everybody pray. Pray for us. Pray for my family. Pray for so-and-so. We're up here at the hospital. The helicopter's coming, and we got a real emergency. Wouldn't it be terrible, Brother David, for your family and my family to fall down our knees to God, call out to God in prayer, and not get anywhere, not even reach the ceiling because of the way we've been treating our wife? Wouldn't that be terrible?
Yeah.
That'd be terrible. Hinder our prayers. Are you hindering your prayers, sir? You hindering them? Let me go ahead and ask. Let me meddle a little bit. Are you getting along? Are you getting along? Any affection in that home? Any tenderness in that home? Any love in that home? Any hugging going on? Any hugging? Any kissing? Any sporting? You say what? Sporting? Yeah, that's in the book of Genesis. The king looked out the window and he saw Isaac sporting with Rebecca, and he wasn't playing tennis either. I'm serious about it. I could preach that. He He wasn't playing hockey and football and baseball and badminton. The Bible uses the word that it was in Abimelech, looked out the window, and Isaac was sporting with Rebekah. Look it up. Look it up. They had no tennis racket in their hand. They didn't have one back then. What do you mean sporting? Look it up. Go ahead, look it up. Conjugal hugs, love, affection, sweet nothings, kissing her on the ear, rubbing her back, whatever else sporting is. Some of you women, I don't like all that sporting. Well, God help you, just move into a convent. This October 31st, get you a nun's costume and you keep that doggone thing around the house 365 days of the year. Your husband likes to play sports. Somebody say amen. That's right. Say amen. That's exactly. I need to preach this. I need to preach it. We got too many cold-hearted, a man and refrigerator women sitting around here. Oh, hell. I'll tell you this, madam. Oh, man, I'll tell you, if there'd be a little bit more sporting going on, there might be a whole lot more honor going on. Yeah. I'm about to blush. Lord have mercy. I don't like messing up. That was Dr. Robbins specialty. That's not mine. Yeah. That spirit resides in this pulpit. Yeah. I could open the door and it'd come rushing out like a mighty wave. Knock me slam back her. And probably a sign in there and say, "You're soft, son. You're soft. And you're a liberal." And he'd probably say, "Preach it like I preached it." I said, "I'm trying. Some people aren't smiling. I'm serious. You know why? Because there's no affection. There's no love. There's no forgiveness. There's no communication. They're not even talking. No communication. How can you have a marriage if you don't communicate? How can you have fellowship? How can you have sports when you can't even communicate? Why have sports when you can't even communicate? You can't talk. You can't fellowship. Definitely no hugs. Definitely no kissing. No date night. No Hardee's. No Burger King. And no Longhorn and Taco Bell's my favorite. Say amen. It's cheap. Say no. I don't. Wage, no. I mean, come on, guys. Come on, man. Come on. It's only about $47 for a fishing pole, and we could spend $20 on her. Somebody say amen. Honor her. There ought to be concentration. There ought to be consideration. There ought to be cooperation. It is together, and there needs to be careful. Does she know you honor her? Does she know it? You used to. Do you still want to? You want to win her? Would you like to win her? I said, would you like to win her? Show her some honor.
Yeah.
Esteem. Elevate her. Don't hurt to brag on her once in a while. You know, what woman in this building doesn't like to be appreciated, maybe bragged on a little bit? A whole lot better than being put down. A whole lot better than being put down. Now, let me ask y'all another question. Tell me a woman in this church, even in this church up there, down. Show me a woman in this church that can take being put down all the time. Tell me one that can take it. Show me one that's strong enough to take being put down and criticized all the time by her husband. By the way, sir, when anybody else puts her down and rebukes her and goes against her and chides and upbraids and verbally abusive to her, it looks like to me that us husbands are supposed to be coming to somebody's defense. It looks like to me somebody ought to be defending. That's what I'm talking about, Savior. Somebody ought to be a protector. For you to agree with your folks against your wife, listen, you are creating disharmony. You are creating hurt. I'm talking about hurt. You're creating feelings that don't have to be created. You're getting it all wrong. I believe our wives deserve our protection. I believe our wives deserve our defense. I believe our wives deserve, Brother Gary, us coming to their aid. That's a savior. That's a protector. That's a defender. That's husbands loving your wife. That's Christ loved the church. Likewise, your husbands, come on, Miss Lauren, please. Dwell with them, and you do believe in dwelling, right?
Yeah.
I'm not talking about no cohabiting. I'm not talking about no shacking up. I'm not talking about living together and experimenting about it.
Right.
And it's definitely not talking about living apart.
Right.
Tell me, church, tell me now, come on, I'm not real smart, but tell me how you dwell with somebody if you ain't living with each other.
Right.
How do you dwell with somebody if you're not staying with each other? That's not dwelling.
Nope.
Dwell with them according to knowledge, giving honor unto the wife as unto the weaker vessel, and as being heirs together of the grace of life. And here's my main text, that your prayers be not hindered.
Right.
That your prayers be not hindered. Let's bow our head, let's close our eyes. Brother Spencer, come up here. Brother Rick Wofford, come up here. Brother Kyle, Brother David, Brother Joe, come on up here, guys. I want every one of you to pray. I want every one of you to pray. Don't pray long. Let's just pray. Brother Rick, lead us, Brother Rick. I want every one of our men to pray. Brother Joe, Brother Rick.
Precious Heavenly Father, Lord, we bow in your presence tonight, Father. Thank you for the truth of the word. Thank you for a man of God, Lord, that wants to help the families of this church, Lord. So goes the family, so goes this house of God. Lord, help us tonight, Lord. We've heard the truth. Lord, been married 47 years, Lord, but I got help tonight. Lord, help me to be that husband, that leader, to honor that wife that you've given me. Lord, I thank you for a man of God that delivers the truth. Help us tonight, Father, to heed your word and to put it into action. In Jesus' name we pray.
Father, we love you tonight. Thank you for the precious word that's been preached to our hearts tonight. Father, I pray that you'd help us, Lord, as you told us in your word. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ loved the church and gave himself for it. I pray that you'd help us love our wives that much. Lord, help us be the kind of leader in our home to be a Christian testimony and example, Lord, to those coming behind us. Lord, help us to be what you'd have us to be, to honor you, Lord, in the way we lead our home and the way we conduct ourselves with our wives, Lord. Thank you for the word that's been preached tonight, for the message. Thank you for our pastor, and we pray that you bless him. May this message tonight, Lord, move down these aisles and these pews and touch hearts and help us, Lord, strengthen our homes, our families, Lord, our husbands and wives tonight through the preached word. And we'll thank you for what you do in Jesus' name.
Our Father in heaven, we love you. We're thankful, Father, for the message and the service tonight. Father, we're sorry, Lord, for not doing what you'd have us do. Father, we're sorry, Lord, for times maybe we've not given honor and we should have. I pray, God, you give us wisdom tonight, to Father, to help us to, Lord, again, dwell, Lord, with our wives according to knowledge and do those things that be pleasing to you. I pray, God, you help us, Lord, in our walk with you. I pray, Father, that you'll help us, Lord, to live so that our prayers and the prayers of our family, the prayers of those we love, Father, be not hindered. Continue to be with God's man as he leads us. I pray, Father, you help us, Lord, again, to walk with you, to have us walk. Father, thank you again for your word and your message. God, just keep your guiding hand on us in our homes and our families. Christ's name.
Well, we thank you for the man of God preached tonight, dear God, Lord. I pray for every young married couple here in this building tonight, dear God, Lord. Lord, we've all faced some of these situations, Lord. I know in my young married life, I'm guilty of all of it, dear God, Lord. And I'm sorry. Lord, I told my wife I'm sorry, dear God, Lord, through the years. Dear God, Lord, it don't make a family home like you want it to be, dear God, Lord. I pray that you touch every house here tonight, dear God, Lord, all these young folks, Lord, it's new to them. They don't know, Lord, what you'd have them to do and how to live together the way you'd have them to. We pray for this man of God that preached the truth and now on how to do that. Dear God, Lord, help each and every family, Lord, they'd love one another, stay with one another, stand by one another. Dear God, depend on each other through the years, dear God, Lord, that their children would grow up in a home where mom and daddy love each other, dear God.
That's right.
Dear God, be every family, Lord, be like man of God, Lord, just my prayer.
Thank you for this good message we heard tonight. For some of us, it's too late. We look back 8 years and listening to what the preacher had to say and how we treated our wife. Oh, if we could bring her back, it'd be different.
Oh, God. Oh, God.
We can't do that. We just have to go on and do the best we can. I just would pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand all over the building. Let's sing a verse of that.